Lenin, Black Gemara, today's daf is Daf Zayin Amud Aleph. So, Bekitzer, we just learned a Mishnah where a husband and a wife have a dispute. He claims, she claims that you married me, I was a psula, a title 200, and he says, no, not, you were a widow, and or you were divorced, therefore you're only entitled to 200. So we said, if there were witnesses that she went to her wedding, to her chuppah, dressed as Psula, then that's sufficient and it's treated like a Psula. Agadech Brucha says different other things, throwing toasted wheat and so on. Then the Mishnah finishes off. Rabbi Shua is Maida. Now remember, the first part of the Mishnah doesn't mention at all a Machlaikis. Suddenly he said Rabbi Shua is Maida is a bit odd. Who's Maida to who? But Rabbi Shua is Maida. That even though I don't believe in Migui, but there's a certain type of Migui that I do, and that is according to Rashi, Pesha Asa Pesha Hitir, or according to Tyson, Migui Di Boy Shasik. In other words, according to Rashi, he came over and volunteered information to certain kids. He said, no, this property is to belong to your father. So he incriminated himself. They had no idea. And then he said, but I bought it. So it's a Pesha Asa Pesha Hitir, such a powerful, compelling reason to believe him that Rabbi Shua says we believe. According to Tyson, we're talking about even in the, if they come and they say, look, this field used to be our father's. And you say, yes, I know. But I bought it from him. That's a very strong Migui. He could have just been quiet and said, I don't know what you're talking about. It was never your father's. And therefore, we believe. So it's a very powerful Migui. And Rashi, they all talk about, so according to Rabbi Shua, the whole idea of Migui doesn't exist. The only time you believe him is if he comes forward and says, this field used to belong to your father. So if a guy comes over to you and says, you owe me $100, and I said, I paid you back, and I have a Migui, I could have said, I never owed you. Maybe I shouldn't be believed according to Rabbi Shua. So how come, you know, the whole idea of Migui is a bit hard to understand according to Rabbi Shua. But anyway, the Gemara. The Gemara is going to discuss what we just mentioned. Who was Rabbi Shua made it to? And the Gemara does a very good summary of all the Mishnahs we learned till now, practically. Says the Gemara, time of DK, the only reason why we believe her is because there were witnesses that she was a psula at the time. If there were no witnesses that she went to the chuppah as a psula, we'd actually believe him. Baal Mehem and the husband's belief. So suddenly here we see that the husband was believed rather than the wife. And we had a number of Mishnahs till now arguing. Rabbi Gamliel Beleza says you always believe her. Rabbi Yeshua says you believe him. And it seems that this Mishnah, who is anonymous, sides with Rabbi Yeshua. They were laying the stomach, but the late Rabbi Gamliel says that Mishnah does not agree with Rabbi Gamliel. And the problem is, before we ruled that the halacha is like Rabbi Gamliel, and we know that a Stam Mishnah generally, the machlek is Baal Chastam, we always follow the Stam. He always said that she's believed. Says Gemara, what are you comparing? How are you comparing this? In all the cases till now, Rabbi Gamliel says you believe her is because she says definitively, this is what happened. It was a mukus aids that happened after you got engaged. And the husband doesn't know. He says, maybe it didn't. Maybe it happened before. Maybe it happened you had a dalliance with somebody. But over here, they're both body. She says, I was definitely a psula. And he says, no, you were definitely an almana when I married you. So here it's a body of a body. Nothing to do with the argument of Rabbi Gamliel Yeshua. It's more answers. Rabbi Gamliel, I can't look at Rabbi Gamliel body b'shama. Allah is body body. Like Amar Gamliel never said in a body body you believe her rather than him. Says Gemara, such an obvious thing with the Kordle and Makordle. What was the question in the first place? Sometimes we have that when you ask a question, the answer is so, you know, staring you in the eye. What were you thinking? A body of body. Isn't this a body and body? Answer the Gemara. Kivan the rave noshim psulas. And he says, vast majority of women who get married are generally psulas. So together with her body, we have a rave. Ki body v'shemadami. Maybe it's treated like he's a body. So she's a body and he's only a shema. The fact that the rave, the majority of cases, the probability supporting her, that takes his shema, his body and turns it into a shema. If it really happened that she was a namana and so on. Now, in fact, the argument is a big machlek is a shenim. When there's a body together with a roiv, even though a body cannot pull out of a shema, we said before that a body, if I say you owe me $100, you say you don't remember, I will not get the money because you have a cheskes mammon. But against that cheskes mammon, I have a body together with a roiv, then I can't pull out of a cheskes mammon. In fact, we'll see that and we'll go to the one about the page, the way Tosfos Yeshanim answers the question. So a body and a coupled with a roiv is stronger than a shema with a cheskes mammon. So so therefore the guy, the questionnaire thought, according to Gamliel, you should believe her. And the one who answers says, no, we hold like the Rishonim, we say that a body and a roiv together still will not override a cheskes mammon. Will not override a cheskes mammon. No, if cheskes mammon is a logical thing, then a body and a roiv is a greater logic than a cheskes mammon. Chesed Mama generally says logic, it's there, you need strong proof to take it away. but a body, the other person is definite, together with a roi that says probably telling the truth, is logically strong enough to take away chesed mammon. But if you learn a chesed mammon, there's no logic to it. It's like there's a cost of the money is there, but we need 100% proof to take it away. Then even though the body has a roi with it, it's still not 100%. Can't take it away. Said you want to prove it to you, make turn to the moider, I'd be sure it's moider. Who is he moider? If you can tell me the first part of the Mishnah, Rabbi Gamliel is admitting to Rabbi Shur and saying, generally I say you believe her, but in this case, I'll agree with you, we're going to believe him. We're going to believe him because it's a body versus a body. So then it makes sense. The second half of the Mishnah, Rabbi Shur is saying to Gamliel, and sometimes I'm moider to you. Where it's, you know, you said that a bari and a migui is strong enough to take, that we believe her. I disagreed, but certain migui's like the one in the Mishnah here, where it's a pesha asa, pesha hita, I agree, that such a powerful migui or a pesha asa, we discussed last time whether it's in the realm of migui or not. Such a strong, compelling proof, they're saying the truth. I'll be mighty that we believe the person who has that pesha asa behind them. So it makes sense in Mishnah. Is Shapit, Eliyam, you can tell me, Lion, I'm going to if you tell me, argues in our Mishnah as well, is Rabbi Shul, who is he Maida to? Says the Gemara. That is, that, even though you answer, it might be a good answer, but that doesn't prove anything for the Mishnah. Because who, this Mishnah is a new Pedic. Who told you that this, and so therefore you think that this Mishnah is that Rabbi Shul is Maida to somebody in this Mishnah? This Mishnah actually is a continuation of the previous Mishnahs, and Rabbi Shul is being made to the previous dinim. Rabbi Gamliel maintains his argument in this Mishnah as well, perhaps, that you believe her body. But when Rabbi Shul says made, he's saying to Rabbi Gamliel, even on the previous Mishnahs, we had an argument, a body with a migvah works, but this kind of migvah does work. Which Mishnah, where do we find the previous Mishnahs that the crux of their argument is whether a migui together with a body is strong enough to take out of someone else's cheskas mammon? And Shemar's going to go through each Mishnah. You think Rabbi Shua is talking about this Pedic when the second half of the Mishnah is discussing the first half and he's being moided to the first half and he's talking about a migui? He's continued. This Mishnah is a continuation of the previous Mishnahs, and Rabbi Shua was reminded to one of the previous Mishnahs, where the Migui was the center focal point. Says the Gemara, hi, which Mishnah did we raise the issue of Migui? And we work our way through every single Mishnah. Elaim, on the last Mishnah, we learned how Yisum Bebedes. She was pregnant, and we asked her, who is the father? And she answered, Mishplani, the Kohen, who is that person who is, could have married a Kohen. Rabbi Gamliel, the man of said, you believe her. Rabbi Shua, we don't trust her. Where does Migui come in there? In fact, there is no Migui there. Because what's a Migui? She couldn't deny it. We see that she's pregnant. So obviously we know she had relations with a man. So what's Migui is there? Hasa my Migui, where's the Migui? I kiss the stomach up between the teeth. Ella, in the following case, the first half of the Mishnah, of that Mishnah, we are Ra'ul Medabedes. We merely saw talking to somebody. What's the story here? And she said, yes, I had relations. I need to play a Kohen, and he's suitable to be a Kohen. In other words, everything is all right. And this, she has a Migui. She could have denied she had any relations. So there's a Migui. And Abu says, we believe her. And Abu Shur says, I don't care. That Migui is not strong enough. Rabbi Gula says, I'm not believe her. Is there really a Migui there? If you remember, we had an argument there between Zaidi and Rav Asi how to understand the Medaberes. If you learn like Zaidi, you said the Medaberes means really they were just talking and we have no idea they had relations. She came forward and said, yes, I had relations, but he was a kosher person, so she had a Migui. She could have said, I did not have any relations. I understand, then you're right. Then Rabbi Shua is discussing that Mishnah and saying, even though I argue with you at that Migui, but in this Migui here, which is so strong, so compelling, I will make it. You're alone in a room in isolation. You could have denied it. Yes, I did. He's Mahabas to believe. But according to Ravasi, the Umber who said, my Medaberes Nivela, Ravasi said, what does Medaberes mean? That we saw them having relations, that we're just talking in Lashon Nekiya. My Migui, there's no Migui. If we saw them having relations, then we would want to know who that person is. She has no Migui. What could she have said? She couldn't have denied it. We saw it. Belaha must be the previous mission. He and Meta, she says, Mukkas Eitz. And she said, before we got married, I was only in Mukkas Eitz. And who I'm alone, no kill. And he says, no, you were in Jerusalem. You had actually relations before we got married to somebody else. So, what exactly they're arguing? So, we had two ways of learning, and we had two ways of understanding. We had Rabbi Yechon and we had Rabbi Lozer. Rabbi Yechon has said that she is this author of the missions of Meir. She's claiming when she said Mukkas Eitz, even though it happened before we got married, she's saying, I'm entitled to 200, the full 200. He's saying no, that you're a Drusha Zish, and according to Rabbi Yechonon, he says that a Kansa Becheskas Psula, you thought that she was a Psula. Turned out to be that she was a Ba'ula, she's still married, and she's entitled to 100. That's not really called cheating to that extent. However, the other view is that the author of the Mishnah is a Rabbana. And the Rabbana say that if you're a Mukkas Eitz before you get married, you're only entitled to 100 because you're not a Psula. So she says, I'm a Mukkas Eitz, I'm entitled to 100. So what's he saying? He's saying, I thought you were a Psula. Turned out to be a Yabula. To Mekartos, you get nothing. Okay, that's the two ways of understanding the Mishnah. So in one of these two ways, she has a Migui. In the case of Rabbi Yechanan, there's no Migui. She said, it happened before we got married. And I'm entitled to 200. So what was the migui? She could have said it happened after you got married. She's still entitled to 200. There's no advantage one way or another. Migui easy could have said a better argument. But according to Rabbi Lazar, she has a migui. She said, yes, it happened before we got married. I was a Mukkas Eitz, I'm entitled to 100. She could have said it happened after we got married and I'm entitled to 200. So there we have a migui, and Rabbi Shua argues and he's saying, but now Mishnah, I agree. So according to Rabbi Lazar, yes, there's a case of a migui. According to Rabbi Yechanan's understanding, there's no migui there. So who's Rabbi Shua being made to according to Rabbi Yechanan? Says Gemara. Like one of us, Rabbi Nevi Shibbol Yishor Amelam Yerachayin. Hossa my migi, what migi is the bish? But when Rabbi Lazar Damar says, Bemana, she claims 100 because it happened before. The Leiklum, and he claims you get nothing because you deceived me. So migi, she does have a migi. That's why we believe her. Nibayama, she could have said, Mukha says any tachtecha, it happened after we got engaged. The Islam Messiah had 200. Could have been a better argument, a stronger argument. And this is a weaker argument. I'm even asking less myself. And now that she said it happened prior to getting married, I'm only entitled to 100. That's a migui. No, she's asking for 200 because the author of the Mishnah is a mayor. And he's only offering her 100. What's her migui? What could be better than 200? My migui. Let's go back a previous Mishnah. The previous Mishnah. He married a woman and it turned out to be she was not a psula. He, I met her. She says, Mishra Stani Nanasi. It happened after we got engaged. I was raped, and therefore, when it's tach for sadeo, you feel got flooded. It's too bad. It's too, and therefore, I'm entitled to the first 200. Now, she has a migui. She could have said she was a Mukkas Eitz. Now, what's the advantage of saying Mukkas Eitz? Either way, she's entitled to 200. The advantage is if she's a Mukkas Eitz, and then her husband dies, she can marry a kohen. But she's saying now that she was raped. When her husband dies, she cannot marry a kohen, even so she harmed herself by with this taina. That's a migui. Before you got engaged, she believes she would be able to kind of trust her. Why? Now, what's the migui here? The migui di boy on Mukkas Eitz, and she could have done Mukkas Eitz and happened after we got engaged. The like kapon nafshel and mikhuna, she's not harming herself from kuna, she's not in any way forbidding herself from marrying kohen. Uka omra, she says, ne nasti, it was an accident. The kapon posla nafshel mikhuna, she passed herself from kuna. Mushum hochi kamen am gamil de hemnet, and those are his belief because of the migui. So this mission here, I'm going to listen to Bishua. Look, that nigga there, I disagree with. Behind nigga, and why do I disagree with that nigga over there? Because I say, who said that she thought of the better time? Maybe she's a liar. What are you saying? That she could have said a better argument. Not everybody's so smart. Or you're nervous. You don't think of the best argument. Or sometimes you convince yourself, if I don't give the best argument, I give a little bit of weaker argument, I look more credible. And I want to look credible in the eyes of the people. Nobody should go walk around, you know, wagging their tongue at me. So there might be a reason why you didn't say the better time. Therefore, Rabbi Shua says it's not that compelling a migui, that kind of a migui. But behind migui the hacha, but over here, this migui here, my din lacha, I made it to you, it's all powerful, and we believe it. But I argue over this. So everyone wants to know what's the difference between the migui. Let me ask you. Hai migui, behind migui, they're both migui, behind migui, what's the difference? So Rashi learns the Gemara as follows. Hach over here ain't sure shachol v'necha. Hach is shachol v'necha. Rashi learns very simple. Rashi learns that if somebody comes to you with a taina, this is the story, and I have to respond. So whatever response I give, Rishu says, and what do you tell me? I could have given a better response. Maybe I didn't think of it. I don't work so quick. I didn't think of it. However, in our Mishnah here, nobody knew where Rashi learns. You had no idea that this field belonged to your father. I didn't have to say anything. So if I volunteered and I came over and I said, this field belongs to your father, but I bought it, in this case, it's such a powerful migui because everybody can understand. Say nothing. Nobody put you on the spot. You don't say anything. And therefore, if you volunteer information, you must be saying the truth. That's how Rashi learns. Traces learns that, no, that this migui is talking about, yes, the kids did say, well, we heard that this field is our father, but had absolutely no proof. And Rabbi Shua says, in this case, because they had no proof whatsoever, it's a very strong migui. They could have just easily denied it. It never was your father's. And nobody would be any wiser because they said, yes, it was your father's, but we bought it, we believe him because this is a strong migui. So what does it mean, shor shachu lefanecha or not shor lefanecha? In the case of the girl over here, the fact that she's not a psula, the facts, you know, speak for themselves. So she had no option to say, oh, that I was a psula is not true. That's called a shor shochel funecha. The facts speak for themselves. And in this case over here, she has to come up with a response, and therefore one thing or another. Over there, there's a field lying there. The facts don't speak for themselves. We don't know whose field it is. These kids say it belonged to our father. So therefore, they easily could have said it's not true. So there's no facts that tell us one way or another. Therefore, it's a much more powerful mikra. Tell you about it further. The majority of women get married. I'm married as a psula, killer us, eight and mahave, who needs witnesses? What about the raiv? Because we can say raiv noshim psula nisa. You're right. On the one hand, you have supporting her, the fact the majority of women get married, us were single. Umiyat almanas, and there's only a minority of women who were widows or divorcees. The chol hanisas psula ishakol. Countering that, generally when there's a wedding in town. For almana, they make usually small weddings, a second wedding. But for a first wedding, you make a big, there's a lot of fanfare and pompous ceremony, and everybody knows about it. Even though you weren't attending the wedding, or you didn't. Nevertheless, everybody knows about this wedding. People talk about it and gossip and so on and so forth. So therefore, the first thing Mara says, every single girl who gets married, everybody's where they get married as a psula. And therefore, that undermines the rave that probably was a psula, because nobody remembers her getting married. So therefore, it undermines the rave of a psula. That's why over here in this case, we don't believe her. It's a little bit that breaks the rave. Says the Gemara, and that's why we need witnesses. Says the Gemara, the one that she went to the chuppah as a psula. E kol hanisas psula yeshiko. Right now, the Gemara thinks that we're saying every single person who gets married, if she's a psula, there's a kail. Every single person then edim are lying, because nobody heard that she was getting married. So kiyos eidim mahavas. What witnesses come? Hanav sadi shakin is definitely a liar, because you're saying every single wedding of a psula, every single one, everybody's aware. Well, nobody's aware of this one. So doesn't that undermine the testimony of the witnesses themselves? Says Gemara Om Ravina, rave hanisas. Take away the word kol. Say rave. Not everyone. The majority. Some people make small weddings. The majority of women who get married, everybody in town is aware of it. Rave hanisas psula yeshlo. So the reason why we don't believe her, even though she has a rave, is because there's a rave that's against it. There's a rave against it, the rave that says, no, that she would have got married as a psula, we would have known about it. But if Aiden come along and say, yes, she got married as a psula, since there are people who get married that nobody's aware of, therefore we believe the Aiden. And Tosha already says that the Gemara's question here is that who cares about witnesses? You have a rave. Remember, Shmuel says you don't go with money matters. Ain holchim b'mamon acharayv. You don't go with money matters after a rave, going after the majority. And therefore, if ain holchim b'mamon acharayv, this Gemara must not be going according to Shmuel, must be going according to Rav. The Tosh Yishanim says no, that in this case here, together with the rave, you have a chazak. The cheska's goof is that most women are psulis. That most the chazak is in her own body that she was a psula to as late as possible. And therefore, the Chazakas Cheskes Haguf tells us that she was only a psula when she got married. And therefore, together with the Bari, you have a Roiv that says that most women who get married are psulas. And you have a Cheskes Guf that she was born a psula, and that probably she was a psula till the very end, till she got married. So the Cheskes Haguf together with the Roiv, even Shmuel will be made strong enough to take away from the husband the Cheskes Mamon. Tell you about it further. There were witnesses that she went out dressed like a mepsula. The question is very simple. It seems to me that it's clear from our mission there was no ksuba available. If the ksuba was there, just look in the ksuba, see what it says. It says 200, it says 100. The reason why they're arguing is because there's no ksuba in town. She has no ksuba, she lost it. So she produces a get and she says, I'm divorced. Or she brings witness her husband died and so on. And the ears are disputing it. So the question is, how can you give her anything? Why aren't we worried that Dilma Mafka Aidin Bahai Bidin the Gavi? She'll bring witnesses here that she was a psula and she'll collect, then Vahada Mafka the high bezin, and then she'll produce the ksuva and some other bezin. In other words, in this bezin she can't go back in because they have a record that she got paid out. She'll go another bezin anywhere in the world and produce a ksuva, and the ksuva is intact, so they'll follow witnesses, everything else. And if her husband owns property in that country, they'll come in and seize it. She will produce the ksuba in some other bezin, the other bezin she will collect from it. Amar Avavu says, you must conclude this. There's a big machlekes the concept of a receipt. According to some, a malva cannot collect his money unless he produces the shtar, the document that he owes the money. If he doesn't produce the shtar, even though he has witnesses the guy owes the money, he doesn't get paid. Because we're worried that you get paid now, and in a year from now, you'll produce the loan contract and collect again. We're worried about that. And therefore, we want to protect the leiva. Others say the other way around. If a malva knows that he loses the contract, he'll never be able to collect his money, even if he has witnesses, he won't lend money in the first place. So therefore, we need to protect the malva and say that even if he lost the contract, he can collect. We have to protect the labor as well. So we say to the labor, you must give him we say to the malva, you must give the labor a receipt that he paid. Now that's the other opinion doesn't like that, because they say then the onus is on the labor to always make sure that he keeps it for the next till, you know, as long as he's alive. It's a big burden. What if he loses it? Then the malva can come along and collect a second time. Why should the labor have to walk around? So the other opinion says, because you have a pasuk, it says eved labor lish malva. A labor, the labor is the one who has to share has to carry the responsibility, the burden of making sure they just get paid, ripped off. So the machlek is whether we write a receipt or not. The reason why those who say we don't write a receipt is because it's not fair that the labor has to walk around the whole time with a receipt. Why we should say to the malva, produce the shtar, you get paid. You don't produce the shtar, you don't get paid. And the other opinion says, no, we got to protect the malva. So the Gemara says from here, the fact over here, there's no ksuva, and yet we're paying her out, must be that she has to write a receipt to the husband. So this proves that we do write receipts. We must prove from here that we do write receipts. And even though it's not fair, the husband has to walk around with a receipt the whole time, because maybe the wife will produce the ksuva, so be it. Rav Papa says, no. Generally, if there is a ksuva, and she says, I lost it, it's gone, she will not be able to collect. Because we don't want to give her the opportunity to be able to produce the ksuv again. And we're not going to say, go write a receipt. It's not fair on the husband. Why should the husband walk around with a receipt the whole time? But we're talking about a case, the makam she'en kaisa ksuv askin. You're talking about a case where there is no ksuv. And because there is no ksuv, you can't tell her, produce your ksuv. There are a lot of areas that didn't write a ksuv because the law was that if you get married, you have to pay out. There's a law of alimony. You don't have to have a document saying that. That's the law. And therefore, in the place where there's no ksuv, then you have no choice. You have to write a receipt. But generally speaking, if there is a ksuva, then she has to produce a ksuva. Otherwise, she gets paid zilch. So that's one way of learning. Vika and others say, Vika the Masna Labraisa and others say, and others say, Abraisa, if the ksuvasa, the following comment of the Braisa, she lost the ksuva, hitmin the ksuvasa, she hid the ksuva, you know, for protection, then she forgot where she hid it. Which I'm sure happens often, Nisif Xavasa got burned, Rogdul Funeva. We have witnesses that they danced before, like a Psula, Sakhul Funeva. They played around with her while during the wedding and they made all kinds of dances and all that to make her happy, which is like a Psula. Heavy Lufanev Kaisal Psula. They passed by in front of her a cup of the Psula of news. We'll talk, see later what that is. This is a cup that tells us, that defines that she is a Psula. All of these are Mapashal Psula, Murshit that were given only to Psulim. She has witnesses, any of these things happen. So when she was a psula, she was $200. I, how can you give her the late? Why aren't you worried? Dilma mafka aidim bahai bezin, she'll produce aidim in one bezin, the gavion should collect. If a hodam mafka looks of us by bezin, then she'll produce a silver in another bezin, the gavion will collect. Why don't you worry that she'll, you know, cheat her husband, deceive her husband? But Abu must be, Zaisamedis, Kaisin Shaver, it must be that she has to write him a receipt. Says the Gemara, the Papa says, the Mokum Shain Kaisin Ksuvas came to a place where they don't write a Ksuva. But in the place you do write a Ksuva, she will not collect unless she produces a Ksuva. Says, well, how can you tell me in this version, how can a Papa say we're talking about a place where you don't write a Ksuva, but clearly says that she hid it, she lost it, it got burned, so there was a Ksuva. So we should say to her, too bad, either produce a Ksuva or you don't collect. But even the Ksuvasik Tani said clearly it was a Ksuva. So it doesn't approve that she has to give him a receipt. And Rabbi Hu is correct. Clearly here that what she lost the ksuva that the husband wrote. Sorry, the kosala iu, he wrote the ksuva. In other words, it's a place that you generally don't write ksuvas, but he decided to give her a ksuva. So he wants to say what? The fact is that in this case there was a ksuva, and the fact is we're not demanding from her to produce it. So the husband is going to lose out unless she gives. Otherwise, tomorrow she'll pull out the ksuva that he gave her. So you say, Mafkale Vigabi, but she will produce it and collect with it. So Moshe says, you're right. My Ivda, Ivda means Ba'ur. It got burnt. The witnesses that saw that it got burnt. So there's no concern that she will produce the ksuba later on. So the Gemara, how can you tell me that? If so, there were three examples in this braisa. One is it got burnt, one is it you hit it, and one is it got lost. You're telling me it got lost means it got burnt. No, so that's so why is the braisa repeat itself? But furthermore, what about in the case where she lost it? The ksuva is somewhere, right? She said, I hid it, I don't know where it is. So one day she might find it, and then she will produce it and harm the guy. Must be that there isn't, must conclude that there are always receipts. Why even mention? Ella called Ivda Kihitmina Bifonenu Dami. When she said she lost it, whenever she said she lost it, just like she told her that she hid it, and she will not connect, and she will not connect. And we will not give her, pay out her ksuba, because it was a ksuba, according to our papa. We will not pay out her ksuba. We're twisting around the words of the Braisa. Not that we will pay her out, we won't pay her out. Add the Amri Aid in this world. So it's not three cases. Case number one is Nisrafa, then we know there's no concern she'll reproduce the ksuva. We are going to pay her out. The other two cases of being lost or being burnt, but there were no witnesses. She hid it or she lost it. In those cases, we are not going to pay her out because maybe she will produce the ksuva again. And we don't say to her, you know, when you collect, go give her a receipt. No, it's too bad. You had a ksuva, you better produce it, otherwise you get nothing. The one who says that Agra Vura Papa is referring to the Braisa is Koshkein Amasnisin. In the case of the Braisa, there was a ksub. And yet it says in the Braisa she can collect. And what and the Rabbi Bur says the only way she can do that is definitely the ksub out there, is by giving a receipt. And Rabbi Papa says no. That you do not collect. My papa said, you do not collect, you don't write a receipt, you don't collect because you need, unless you have witnesses that they got burnt. And my papa said, you don't write a receipt. And here there's a masnisit. Surely, in the case of the Mishnah, that in a place where you don't write any ksuvas, surely there's no risk. That the only time you write a receipt in a place where you don't write ksuvas. Man the master assist, the one who learns on the mission, the machlek the papa rabbi who is only on the mission. I will abraise the loy. But in the case of the braisa where there was a the person decided to write a ksuba to his wife, then a papa will be made that you have no choice. In this case, she will write a receipt. And therefore there's no argument. Who's like our question? Then he said in Bishain or Aiden that she wants that she behaved like a psula. If she brings witnesses that she was a psula, why aren't we should produce witnesses that she were at the wedding, that yes, she went like a psula, the gavi should collect the psula, and the gavi, she got to another bezin, bring other two witnesses, not the same ones, who were at the wedding, or it might have been 100 people at the wedding, and another bezin, collect the psula again, the gavi. See, Mora says the mokin left. In the case we have no choice, for example, in a place where nobody writes a ksuva, says she, so we can't ask her to produce a ksuva, then you get paid. And the only way that she collects is she brings witnesses to prove that she was a psula. So we're scared that maybe she'll go to another bezin and she'll bring other witnesses, not the same one, and she'll collect a second time. So Mora answers the mokin left. Shabbatik is in shabbat. We have no choice. You have no choice. Everyone will agree. You write a receipt. This cup of news of that she's absurd in my culture. What in the world is that? That she's absurd. They bring her as a token or symbolic. They bring a cup of wine of truma. They pass in front of her. As if to say, she's absurd and therefore she could have eaten truma. Says the Gemara, and Almana cannot eat truma. Masked a papa, Otamon milach truma. If Almana marries a kohen, she's not entitled to eat truma. So what does that prove? You had a cup of truma passing in front of her. It proves nothing. Elon a papa zureishis kitrumas reishis. A papa says, what you mean by truma is the first of your crop, the first of your yield. You have to give to a kohen. This too. This is the first of herself. She's giving over to this man over here. Says the Gemara, Tanya, we join me. Chavish the yain to pass a barrel of wine in front of her. That's what they used to do, bring a barrel of wine, not truma, but they should pass a barrel of wine by a psula. The difference is as follows. By a psula, ma vidin l'fenas tuma, a sealed barrel, symbolic that what that she was sealed till now. And bula ma vidin l'fenas tuma, by a bula, they bring a barrel that was open. It's pretty embarrassing if you ask me, but they used to parade with a barrel that was wide open to say that this is not her first time. So the Gemara says, why are you embarrassing the psula? Yeah, okay, the bula. Let's do the following. Am I never come a psula, become bula, never cloud. Let's just, in front of a psula, we'll parade with this barrel that are closed, sealed. But for a bula, don't bring it at all. Why bring an open barrel when you're sort of humiliating her? Or telling the whole world her story, of private life. So you must say, no, we have no choice. We have to do something by bula to counter what we do by psula. Because otherwise, Zina, the Tafsa Messiah, she might go ahead and grab $200 from her husband's estate, and she will claim that she was a psula. And then we bring these witnesses who say about, if they say there was no barrel, if the laws, you don't bring a barrel, no barrel. She'll say, you know what, because we ran out of wine. We couldn't afford wine or whatever it is. The barrel broke. So, and she has it now. Go prove her wrong. You know why I didn't bring it in front of me? It was an accident. And that is why the Gemara, that we say that if we make a takana for psula, we must make something proactive also for the ba'ula. So this way people remember either a psula or a bula, and there's no excuse that she cannot grab if she's not entitled to.